day in Manhattan, clear as could be, till the planes hit the buildings and changed history. They stood for an hour once the damage was done, but then suddenly crumbled. 10 seconds they were gone. There were cascading projections of steel into dust. Looked like explosions, but it was not disgust. So I turn off the TV and shut out the lights. It's all just illusion right in front of my eyes. Well, I'm not scared of dying. We're all bound for heaven, just sharing the truth about 9/11. Now building number 7 dropped the cleanest of all, yet the world still knows nothing of this amazing free fall. There was no real reason. It wasn't hit by a plane. They say it was a fire, yet you can't see the flames. You see cascading projections of steel into dust. Like demolition, but it's never discussed. So I turn off the TV and shut out the lights. It's all just illusion right in front of my eyes. Well, I'm not scared of dying. We're all bound. The bigger the lie, the more people believe. And the deeper the fear, the more easily we are deceived. Turn off the TV and I shut out the lies. It's all just illusion.
Boy, that's a really good song. Every time I play it at the beginning, and I play it all 4.5 minutes because it sums it up. It really does. Well, I got some emails from those of you that were expecting a posting last Saturday, and we were preempted by a class or something here in Studio B, so we had to play the previous week's show. So this is actually the next show from 2 weeks ago. And being April 19th, it's the anniversary of couple of tragic things. For instance, remember Waco? Yeah, that was a good old American tradition brought up to date. You know, church burning? That's what that was. Good old fashioned, good old American custom of church burning. Okay. And then how about following it up was the test for 9/11 to see if they could get away with blowing up a building. The federal building in Oklahoma City. Remember that? That was blamed on Timothy McVeigh, but Timothy McVeigh didn't plant all the explosives in that building either. So, you know, that we've got that was actually the test case for blowing up the Trade Center towers. But anyway, we've got another tragedy we're going to talk about today, and that is a respected member of the 9/11 community, Michael Ruppert, who was the L.A. cop who busted the CIA for running cocaine in the 70s. And he's the author of this book, Crossing the Rubicon. Apparently last Monday, this week, he committed suicide. Yeah, we're not afraid of dying, but apparently he was afraid of living, or living was too painful for him. We don't know exactly. But his lawyer on the website collapse.net wrote, I believe that's where I saw it. Anyway, I was looking all over to find out more information, and I found a close personal friend of Michael Ruppert's named, I forget the name, anyway, his lawyer, and he wrote on the letter that he swears on his personal honor that he will let everybody know what happened, no matter what it turns out to be. But right now it looks like it was just actually a suicide, no conspiracy theory involved. But Michael Ruppert wrote many books and did many things. Well, Abby Martin, one of my favorite commentators from Russia Today, did a 5-minute kind of eulogy about Michael Ruppert, and I think she said it best, so we're going to play that now.
I have to close out the show today with a very heavy heart. This week, the world lost a true warrior. Michael C. Ruppert took his own life on April 13th after closing out his last radio show, The Lifeboat Hour. A world-famous activist and investigative journalist, Michael was first thrust into the public spotlight back in 1996 as a former LAPD narcotics detective who was confronted when he confronted the former head of the CIA, John Deutsch, about the CIA running drugs into the country and facilitating the inner-city crack epidemic. Check it out.
I was personally exposed to CIA operations and recruited by CIA personnel who attempted to recruit me in the late 70s to become involved in protecting agency drug operations in this country.
This fearless move ultimately caused Deutsch to step down from the CIA, but Michael only persevered and continued to tell his story from a hard-hitting newsletter covering government corruption and cover-ups called From the Wilderness. There, Michael helped blow the lid off the true circumstances and gross negligence surrounding football star Pat Tillman's friendly fire death that ultimately helped lead to Donald Rumsfeld's resignation. Unfortunately, Michael was also cast as a conspiracy theorist just because he refused to shy away from controversy that others wouldn't touch. His first book, Crossing the Rubicon, outlined evidence pointing to insider trading on 9/11. Alleging that members of the Bush administration and Wall Street had colluded with the 9/11 perpetrators for financial gain. But perhaps most notably was Michael's groundbreaking research in the subject of peak energy, specifically oil. His insightful predictions became the subject of a 2009 documentary called Collapse. It was an exposé about the coming crash of human civilization due to the current models of unsustainable growth, ecological trends, and financial instability. Here's a clip.
What will the final outcome be? I don't know. It's a movie. And it's a movie we're all living in. We don't know whether the movie has a happy ending, a sad ending. We don't know whether everyone dies. We certainly know it's impossible for everybody to continue to live and keep consuming the way that we have. All of the resources on this planet, the fresh water, the food, and everything else. So we don't know how it's going to end.
It is a movie, and Mike was much more than a passive viewer of life's unfolding reel of time. In 2010, Michael founded the Collapse Network to build an online community and conscious support network of activists, not necessarily to stop the impending collapse of industrial civilization, but to build a future beyond it, one of conscious living and spiritual enlightenment. Here he is on this show talking about why we need to throw our bodies onto the gears of the machine.
I have a saying that I use called fire your weapon, and it has nothing to do with guns and firearms. It has to do with whether your expression of dissatisfaction, desire for change, is an email, a letter to your congressman carrying a picket sign, being a blockade in front of a Coca-Cola ramp or a railroad line shipping weapons, find a weapon and fire it. And we must not believe that we are helpless victims. We must act as if we make a difference now, because the only alternative is to lay down, give up, and die. And I'm not like that, and I know you're not. And I know all the people who are watching shows like this deeply want to be involved in this shift in consciousness.
Fighting words that I will take to my grave. And as this show went on, Mike and I spoke often. He would write me with his support for what I did and express the faith he had in my work. But Michael also struggled with depression, and he'd announced many times that he was plagued with despair. There's only so much pain one can absorb, and there's only so much burden of the world one can hold on their shoulders. And if anyone watched his series Apocalypse Man on Vice, excuse me, you knew that death was the last thing he was afraid of. In fact, he seemed to embrace it as if it was a leap of evolution during the later months of his life. Michael, you are my friend and my spiritual brother. I took advantage of knowing that you were there and that you would be there when I needed a friend and confidant later on. But even though you won't physically be there, I know you still will be. And the rays of the sun and wind whipping through the air, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. So rest in peace, Michael C. Ruppert. Your insight and passion will be truly, truly missed. We'll do our best to carry on the struggle without you, but I truly regret not telling you just how much you were loved and needed by us. I have to close out this show today with a very...
Okay, that's a real good thing to think about. If you love somebody, you better tell them. Might be too late. Well, anyway, it's hard to keep a straight... You know, no tears in your eye after seeing Abby. That was funny that I can't do that. But anyway, we've got on a happier note. We're going to think outside the box a little bit here. And I have a guest here that some of you might recognize. It's Alex Ansary, formerly Outside the Box here on this channel. And we need to put up that phone number. That's the problem with this background. You can change back to that other background that has the phone number so people can call in. I know people will be wanting to ask Alex what he's been doing and all that. So we're going to start out right now by where he's been and where have you been and what are you doing? What are your plans?
Well, good to be back, Bill. It's good to be back in the studio, and thanks for playing that video. I remember interviewing Michael Ruppert here in studio in 2005, and it was actually here in Portland, Oregon, where that 9/11 lecture that he gave at Portland State University went down, I think, in October 2001. And that speech that Michael Ruppert gave reached the world. And he was one of the first people on the scene to lay out the money ties between Wall Street, the CIA drug running, 9/11, and so many other things that you can learn about in Crossing the Rubicon.
Yeah, this Crossing the Rubicon book, you really need to get it. Mine is almost dog-eared now. Well, not too bad. I treat my books pretty well, but it's got at least 3/8 of an inch of references in the back. You know, whenever you look at a reference book or any book that somebody's writing, you know, check out and see how many references they have. Do they have any? You know, it makes a big difference. You can tell right away the type of fiction or nonfiction it's going to be.
Mm-hmm. So as far as me coming back to Portland, and it's the short story is that the last episode that some people or period of time that I was here was late 2011, I believe, around September. Mm-hmm. And at that point, I had been on the air here about 6 years.
The last show you did here, we did
right,
live
it was on 9/11.
From Texas.
There was actually a show after that. That's right, where we connected on Skype.
Yeah, we did an experiment with our old system that was still standard definition, and he answered all the phone calls from Texas.
That was fun.
Yeah.
And you had to relay them back. And, you know, I did go to Dallas, Texas for about a year. I accepted a job working at a video production company, and that lasted about a year. And, you know, there was a lot of people wondered why I left Portland. And, you know, for people that have been watching what's been going on with the economy, the job situation, you know, a lot of us got hurt pretty bad in the last couple of years, especially 2009, 2010, especially after I lost my job. So after being on the air for about 6 years in Portland, when a job opportunity did open up outside of Portland, you know, I took an opportunity to experience more of what life was like outside of a city that, for the most part, I grew up in, even though I've traveled to a lot of places in my life. I actually grew up in Aurora, Oregon, when I was a lot younger. There was a lot of curiosity that I had about life in Texas, and that 1 year in Dallas actually led to something larger, which I'll talk a little bit about tonight, what I really took from my travels.
You said it's cheaper to live in Dallas, huh?
Well, there's more jobs in Dallas. Oh. It depends on what neighborhood you're living in. And we could talk a little bit about Dallas, but it led to me living off the grid in Colorado. Because I remember for years, you know, putting a lot of emphasis on being self-sufficient, ready for a disaster, ready for some sort of emergency. But I was still, you know, living in the city for the most part, you know, working within the system, paying my taxes, and I didn't have any of that experience. So I lived for about 10 months without technology, in the middle of the desert, the San Luis Valley of South Central Colorado. And through a series of synchronicities, things happening by accident, some people may see it as a coincidence, some people may see it as divine intervention, things were thrown in my path that ended up with me finding a yurt and finding firewood and developing the friends and allies, not through the internet, but randomly. And so it was a beautiful year of reflection. And after putting a lot of, you know, my life into Access TV and Outside the Box TV, you know, it was good for me to have a break and also reflect on certain things. And then from there, I went to Kansas City, Missouri, and stayed with a few friends for a few months. And it was at that point that I wouldn't say homesickness kicked in, but just kind of an awakening to a point that I had traveled enough. And I felt like it was time to come back to Portland and bring back Outside the Box TV. And so after a few years, exactly 2.5 years of being away, I made the decision to come back. I did come back without a home and immediately started living in my truck. And it's been an amazing urban survival experience in the last few weeks. But I'm remaining hopeful. I'm doing a lot of praying. And I am very motivated right now to bring back the series on a weekly basis to Portland Community Media. I did leave up some links for some of my places where you can find my work on the web in the meantime.
Okay, we just got a phone call here, and I was handed a message here. It's Wesley T. Miller. It says, Associate of Michael Ruppert is online right now. So go ahead. Hello, you're talking to Bill Olson and Alex Ansary.
Hi. I didn't realize your program was happening, or I would have made preparations to call in. My name's Wesley T. Miller. I'm Mike's attorney, his friend, his business partner in CollapseNet.com.
Yeah, I was reading your letter. I was talking about that just now. I guess you heard it.
As soon as I saw the channel talking about 9/11 inside job, I had my son click on it and saw Mike's book up, and I just picked up the phone right away.
Good for you.
I had no idea what was going on. I just had to call in.
Thank you.
Anything you guys want to know, I am publishing everything about everything. there are no secrets here. I'm going down to Calistoga, and I'm going to go to his cremation. I'm going to view his body before the cremation, and I'm going to get the police reports, coroner's reports, and photos and everything just to tell the public with absolute 100% confidence, which I already have. But
right,
it is what it is. And he did this on purpose, and he felt it was a sacrifice. I mean, read the note that he left. But he had set this up for so many years. He's been suicidal. I reached out to him to prevent this day from ever happening. I did.
It's awful hard.
I've been crying most of the week. And I gotta, you know, keep it together to talk to you guys. But anything you have to ask, fire away.
Well, I'm just gonna say first of all, this show is on live every single Saturday now. So as you get more information, feel free to conduit through here. And I publish this on YouTube also, so
okay, it
hits some people. You could always download a section of it or whatever and use it yourself as you choose.
Have you referenced Abby Martin's RT tribute to Mike yet?
Oh, we just got done playing it just before you came on the air. And that's why I was crying.
I've never met Abby. I'm sorry. I've never met Abby, but I wish I could give her a hug because that was so beautiful and heartfelt and nailed it.
If you look down below that video on YouTube, somewhere you'll see my comment that I said, dear Abby, I said, I share your despair and I weep with you. I said, if I had the honor of being your friend, I'd be there with you and for you. But, you know.
Yes. Let me tell you a little bit about, you know, there's people who want to spin this shit around. Can I get away with that on cable?
Yeah, we got away with it.
All right. And I'm going to tell you, I'm going to tell you the story that Mike has told so many of his friends. Anybody who knew him well has heard this story about Gary Webb and why I'm so adamant about having the absolute truth told. And even the goddamn gun he used was a message to me. And he wanted me to tell the story, to tell the truth all the way. And so Mike gave Gary Webb's eulogy. They were friends. And because he was a police officer and a detective, the police were very accommodating. They took him through the scene. They showed him the, you know, all the autopsy photos and the coroner's report. And it was very obvious to Mike that, yes, Gary Webb shot himself in the head two times. The first time he had a last-second reluctance. He jerked the shot. Like somebody jumping off a building and screaming and regretting it as soon as they did. You know, it was that kind of thing. And he disfigured himself. He blew his jaw out. And he walked to a mirror and saw himself. This is exactly the story that Mike has told all of us. He walked over to a mirror and he saw how badly he had already disfigured himself. And then he took the fatal shot.
Wow.
That is how Gary Webb had two shots in the head with his own suicide. Now, Mike would probably be fucking angry. Might be leap there, but he'd be angry maybe that I told this story, but it's necessary to tell his story. And there were some people from another controversial figure that's called a conspiracy theorist, whatever. I'm not going to honor him by mentioning his name. But Mike hated his guts for this reason. There were a couple of his guys roaming around creating a false story of Gary Webb's death. Gary Webb had a 14-year-old daughter and a wife that he left behind at that time, and they were traumatizing the family. And it so infuriated Mike. So you can go read From the Wilderness, and you know he talks about it as much as he could, that he felt he could publicly, but that's the backstory to all this. So that is why I have to make sure the public sees it all.
What?
It is, and Mike would never, that guy would not, he was a gun expert, he was ex-cop, he was a great firearms instructor, and he, you know, with all the Gary Webb history, I know that he made sure he didn't miss. You know, I without even being there, I know that. So anyway, go ahead and ask me anything.
Okay, Wesley, this is Alex. Okay, I was going to ask you a couple of things. Some of the people out there that are pretty familiar with Michael Ruppert and his mental state, some of his recent interviews, it's not a surprise for quite a few people that this took place. What signs for you, or what did he verbalize that you can kind of quote? What were some of the things that he said that are some of the things that you know or clues that he, in fact, did kill himself?
Well, number one, when he left CollapseNet, I published that on our website, CollapseNet.com. The last email of July 19th of 2012, when he was just leaving California to move to Colorado, he said it in that email that he was contemplating killing himself, and then we had a phone conversation. There's at least one other CollapseNet manager that was on that phone call that can, you know, back this up. He was about to kill himself at that time, in Sebastopol, and his friend Doug Lewis called, mm-hmm. and with the idea of going to Colorado, and he, you know, he felt like it was spirit calling to him, and as he's talked about and written about in the email, and that you can see at our website. So he verbalized this, he laid it out there, but it wasn't the first time. I am just glad that he didn't have any other violence in him, that he didn't want to hurt anybody. He wanted to save everybody. Right. But he wanted to go out with a warrior's death that wasn't given to him. And if you go to YouTube, there's a video I made for in October of 2011 called Occupy Wall Street Explained to a Five-Year-Old. I dedicated to Mike because the reason I dedicated that to him, we were kind of grinding at the time, fighting a lot, but he was heavily involved with Occupy, and that wasn't the grind. But he expected to get his head bashed in the next day at the confrontation with the Santa Rosa police, and it went completely the other direction. They defused it, and, you know. But that's why I dedicated it to him, because he was laying that out there. He wanted to die a warrior's death, and nobody would give that to him in the end. So he felt he put himself up on the cross and took his own life as a sacrifice, but not in a Christian kind of way, in a Native American spiritual way that he believed was his last message to get people to pay attention to what the F he was saying.
Self-censor, that type.
And I don't agree with timelines. His biggest Achilles heel was putting a date on doom.
Right.
You know, I mean, his greatest analytical gifts were getting the path right, connecting the dots, but his biggest Achilles heel was trying to say it's going to happen on this day, you know, or this month.
I have a quick thought on that. When you put a date on it, I mean, when you let people know about those things, I think the act of them finding out delays it.
Right.
I'll be talking on my first show back on Access TV why I went to the same part of Colorado that he did to kind of deprogram myself and immerse myself in nature from that very belief system that's very prevalent and popular. You mentioned another unnamed person that is a purveyor of fear porn earlier. So there's a lot of that deprogramming that I think a lot of us need to do in order to create that world of hope where we actually believe that there is a tomorrow. And
there's a huge difference between me and Mike in that I have children. The reason I did everything with him was, number one, to try to save him from this day happening, because I saw it. And my story is, you know, I've been on the back burner. I used to say, he got the glory, I got the heartburn, you know, as far as collapsing and all. But my story is coming out. Yeah, I have books to write, put it that way. But my motivation was, number one, to help the guy out, because I recognized where he was at and why, how he felt. You know, I've been in that isolated space, doing the right thing for the right reasons and getting persecuted for it. You're feeling that way.
Well, Wesley,
but my kids, it's my kids. It's, you know, if... All of this matters. You know, the entirety of the human species has gotten to this point. We have, you know, the greatest technology ever, but we're killing ourselves with it, and we refuse to look ourselves in the mirror and do something about it. Anyway, yeah.
I was going to say, Wesley, if there's my number and email will come up later. If you would like to maybe meet up and do a video on, you know, go a little deeper.
I'm available to all you guys. So, CEO at CollapseNet.com. Email me. Any media contact wants to talk to me. I am an open book about everything.
Okay.
Cool.
Well, I'll follow up when I have time. I just moved back here, but I would like to follow up and do a video. So Collapse.net.
Cool.
Okay.
CollapseNet. No. CollapseNet.com. It's short for Collapse Network, Inc., which is the actual corporate name. And so it's, you know, condensed online, collapsenet.com. People get that wrong all the time, and I don't want you to get astray. Yeah. Anyway.
Okay.
And remember, as I said, we're live every Saturday, and I haven't always thrown the phone lines open, but I try to because it's supposed to be a live call-in show. And if you have any updates at the spur of the moment, feel free to just call up anytime.
Hey, you guys can call me too.
Okay.
I am available all the way, open book. That's what Mike would want. Good, bad, indifferent. But I don't want people to turn his suicide into some conspiracy theory stuff that would
right.
he would haunt me for letting
right.
that happen.
The feds
you
know? Took
we'll
him out.
We'll make sure
man.
We get
yeah.
that message out there.
All right. And so yeah, and there are a lot of other people that have a lot of deep history with Mike. I just have a chunk of it, but I'm available, open book, anytime you guys want to talk.
Okay, well, I really thank you for calling. It really put some substance into this issue here.
And you know what? It was interesting to see the topic line there, and you guys showing crossing the Rubicon, because within the last couple of weeks before Mike left, that's the whole thing has been on my mind. I've been talking to my family about Mike threatening suicide and thinking about the whole 9/11 issue a lot out of nowhere. And it's just kind of, you know, it's like Mike has been talking to me for a while before he did it, you know? Anyway.
Okay, well, I guess we'll be in touch.
All right. Well,
yes,
thank
we will.
You guys for doing what you're doing. Again, there's been a media blackout about this, and that is the most upsetting thing.
Right.
Next to the people trying to make it a conspiracy thing, the next thing is a media blackout, and Mike deserved the attention that Abby gave him.
Yeah, and it's sad that that this little cable access, you know, we scooped all the
right.
NBC guys and everybody.
I'll be emailing you, Wesley, guaranteed, the next 24
hey,
hours. I'm emailing
you'll get
you.
It back.
All right.
All right.
Thank you very much. Yeah, now,
because when we could sit down, we can expand on his thoughts and get it on video if he cares
true.
To when we do that.
Now, you saw me wiping my eyes with this red bandana, but this red bandana is actually pretty darn special. Let me hold it up for you. You see what it says? Iron Workers Convention, 100th Anniversary, 1996. This was a treasured piece whatever you call it. An icon that a friend of mine, a steelworker, had. Actually, I didn't know him. He's a friend now, basically. I haven't talked to him for a long time. But he saw this show, and he came up to the show, and he gave this to me, and he said, "You know about iron." He says, "The way you told about iron is exactly right." He says, "I worked with iron all my life." He says, "I'm giving this to you so you know that I'm telling you the truth." And he gave me this. The 100th anniversary convention has still got his iron working dirt on it. And anyway, when an iron worker calls you up and says that, you know, NIST got it wrong, what more do you want to know?
Well, I just want to thank you for continuing the show all these years and reminding people that this is a very important issue. And this is the issue that brought me to Access TV. In 2004 and 2005,
that's
for
right.
a lot of different reasons. More personal than most Americans, being born half Afghani, half white. And so being from a bloodline that's labeled,
you remember how all the bad guys were Saudi Arabians? We had to go after Afghanis.
But even people.
Sorry.
and we see what has been the result, Bill, since then. Millions
right.
dead.
Anybody with brown
millions,
skin.
Millions dead in Iraq and Afghanistan. I would say it's not so good juju for the U.S.
Yeah.
Now you look at geopolitics now with Russia and China. There's something coming from, we don't, but we'll expand upon that in future shows, from what 9/11 started.
Yeah, we're
not done yet with what's going down.
I see that we have a telephone call waiting, but wait a second. I'm just going to point out that we keep hearing on the news how Russia is the aggressor, you know, but it turns out that if you actually check out the situation, does Russia have military bases surrounding the United States? Does China have military bases surrounding the United States? Do either of those have over 1,000 military bases in other countries? Well, wait a minute. I think they might have it a little backwards who the aggressor is.
Well, there's definitely a propaganda war taking place. Absolutely. On all different sides right now to get people into that nationalistic box. But 9/11 was definitely the issue that brought me here, and that was definitely the focal point of my earlier years. And that's why I say it's good that people are still reminded of the issue, because there are so many people still in this day and age that refuse to believe the obvious reality, basic physics, to basically look at something with an open mind, to basically wonder, well, is it really fair for millions to be literally removed from the planet, murdered because of this large lie, this large manufactured event? And you were talking about earlier the other false flags throughout history, suspected ones on this date.
Today I wanted to try to find some sort of good video on Waco, and you don't find any better than the Noble Lie. I mean, that's not Waco. That's
Oklahoma
City.
Oklahoma City.
Yeah, but Waco was the same type of thing. There's all kinds of video that you can get on that, especially the tremendous expose of the satellite photos that show that the feds did fire machine gun fire into. They said, we didn't shoot them at all. We didn't shoot. Well, anyway, those are both tragic days. Did we ever have a caller? I thought you guys blinked. Well, anyway, we also have a... Oh, we do have a caller. Okay. Hello, caller.
I don't mean to interrupt the flow, but I just wanted to call and comment. Good to see you back in town, Alex. Looking well, and I do look forward to your programming in the future. And a comment on Michael Ruppert. Sad to hear of his passing, and I was wondering, and I'm not sure about all the copyright restrictions and everything, but if it would be possible for Portland Community Media, one of the producers down there, to maybe begin re-airing.
You can reduce that weird sound.
I can still hear you.
Maybe begin re-airing occasionally the Michael Ruppert presentation from Portland State back in 2001.
I'll see if it's still on file. I'll ask a staff member. I don't know what the policy is on re-airing certain things, but I think they still do air documentaries that have been on file for years, so I'll check on that.
Okay, yeah, that would be great. And then one more comment. A few shows back, there was Bill, you were commenting on the Pentagon and the misnomer of Defense Department and how they don't defend anything. They're out there offending people. And I got to thinking that, they actually do defend people. They defend the people and corporations that create the reasons for their excursions. They defend the people that appropriate the funds for their existence. So, in a sense, they do defend something. They just don't defend the American citizens. Yes. Anyway, thanks again, and I'll enjoy the rest of the program. Thank you.
Thank you. You notice that the only thing that our legislator and senators seem to agree upon is the sending arms somewhere or starting a war somewhere. It seems like it's not important which way or who does what, as long as we continue to sell weapons to both sides. That seems to be the most important thing in our foreign policy.
I want to add to that.
Yeah.
Now, you're talking about this fallacy that these other countries are threats, and I hear you, and there's definitely a propaganda war, but at the same time, there is this military-industrial complex that has been arming the whole world to the teeth. Even North Korea, there's a corporation that Rumsfeld was ahead of that hooked them up with their light water nuclear reactors. We can look at the Chinese missile technology. Some of the shows that I'll be doing in the future won't be new shows on everything that happened that week. That will be focused themes. So it'll take a full hour and work to break down what it is that I'm saying now. That there's a whole international network of weapons traders that are far beyond the organized criminal ones that the UN focuses on, that's actually above government. And that's what needs attention, because it appears that they're setting the stage for the real World War III or World War IV, depending on how somebody looks at it.
I think that it's real important for people to go to YouTube and look up Network again and view that scene where he said, there is no country, there's only, and he goes down the list, there's only IBM, there's only, he names all the corporations, and that's the way it really is. And so it's kind of hard to imagine our legislature ever changing its mind on funding war.
Right. Speaking of corporations and debt, I was a little disappointed to come back to Portland and find out that because of a few parking tickets, there's a warrant out for my truck. And so, you know, yes, Portland's viewed as progressive to a certain level, and I think there's something special about the city and some of the people that are here and the creative energies that are here and the activist spirit. But I also see the corporate dominance, the influence, the target in downtown Portland, the higher rates, utilities going up, up, up and away. And I can definitely see how in the 2.5 years since I've been gone, by Portland being named the number one city to move to in the United States, what that's done to the cost of rent, what that's done to levels of jobs being available, and what that's done for the lives of homeless. Because a lot of them are being swept out of certain corners. So there's a number of things that I've noticed that are happening here in Portland that are less than progressive, that still need our attention. And I want to commend KB Radio for a great show a few nights ago where they were talking about how the Portland police are experimenting on the homeless. They're setting up their own intelligence agencies in a way. They're practicing on the homeless, maybe for what they're going to be doing later on down the line.
I have some friends that are fighting that, yeah.
In addition, the nightclub scene in downtown Portland, the police have installed these cameras, as you probably read in Willamette Week or saw in the local news. In these nightclubs and the bouncers that now have to be certified by the state, the old world is gone. You just can't hire the tough guy of your choice. He's got to be certified in the police state. Well, they're scanning these IDs, so in the databases, the Portland police know who's in those buildings. That's creepy. That's not CIA. That's not federal government. That's our own locale. So we definitely need to keep the focus on the military, in addition to other things. Militarization of local police, JTTF, FBI, Portland police working together, and whoever else the Portland police in the city of Portland's working with. I heard that the mayor of Portland is not allowed to see the JTTF plans. That sounds like Peter DeFazio, who was on that Homeland Security Committee when he wasn't allowed to see Bush's contingency plans.
What is that, the Joint Task Force? And it was Joint Terrorism Task Force.
Went into effect in 2010 after the staged, because they took that guy from Somalia. They took him to Lincoln County. They showed him how to blow up a backpack. They recruited him on the internet. All the facts came out in the Oregonian. Front page news, doesn't matter. They used that event where they coaxed that person down to Pioneer Courthouse Square, and everybody was freaking in Portland one day in 2010 where they were told this guy tried to blow up your downtown. And it was all set up by the FBI. Yeah, now they're here.
The FBI, we did shows on that, how the FBI continually saves us from these terrorist plots, and it turns out that they were the FBI's terrorist plots that they carefully set up so they could save it. Because they can't catch the actual terrorist plots, if there are any. But by golly, they sure are. They're pretty easy to catch if you invent them yourself.
That's true. And Hal Turner.
We do have a phone call.
Hal Turner was an FBI informant, by the way, as a white supremacist. That's also something people might want to look into.
Okay, caller. You're on the air. And by the way, I turned down the volume too low on that telephone. Just bump it up a little bit more. But I don't hear the guy at all. Are you there?
We can hear you.
Okay, go ahead.
Am I on?
Yes, you are. I think.
That would be you.
Pardon?
Yeah, go ahead.
You're on the air.
Yeah, I never got to hear much information about the plane that went down in the field in Pennsylvania. Can you get any kind of video and bring that up on your show?
Yeah, there's not very much there except the lack of any, there doesn't seem to be any of the plane's debris, and if I recall, what they claimed was that it hit the ground so hard, and right where there happened to be a mine shaft, and the entire plane debris and all those people and any luggage went down that shaft and pulled dirt in after it and buried itself. And our technology just isn't sufficient. We could dig the mine shaft in the first place, but we can't redig it to get any of that plane out.
Yeah.
But somebody said that they recovered 93% of the plane from Philadelphia, or 95, some huge percentage of the plane, and I don't believe they've recovered any of it. So I want to know if anybody's heard that claim about the recovered plane from Pennsylvania. I'd sure like to know the reference material.
Yeah. Also, I got a little something to say about that Sandy Hook elementary school shooting.
Yeah.
I'm sick and tired of hearing all these politicians, all these idiots on TV keep talking about, what can we do? What can we do to prevent this and that? These old guys all go to Harvard, Yale, and all these other schools. I've never once heard anybody mention combination lock gun safe. Four words. If this woman was, she had plenty of money. She lived in a beautiful house. She bought, like I heard, about four assault weapons and an automatic pistol, probably a dozen boxes of various ammunition. She had an unstable child at home. She was supposed to be an educator of some sort. Now, she should have had the brains when she was in the shop looking at all these weapons to look over and say, what's those things that look like big refrigerators? Why do you got those in here? Well, those are gun safes. You lock up your weapons so other people can't take them and use them on you. I've never heard anybody ever mention those four words. I believe that would have prevented the whole situation. I'll take your comment on the air. I love your program. I was wondering who the heck you were. I always see your name as a producer, and now I know who you are. Thank you.
Okay, well, I think that the whole key to the story of those shootings, if you take these shootings at face value without trying to inject sometimes very valid conspiracy theories about the government's involvement, but just take it on face value from the first part of it, the one thing that every shooter seems to have in common is that he's taking these drugs called SSRIs. That's selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors. Now, that's a great big line of medical talk, but what it boils down to is the people who take that, it's like when you're watching TV and they're trying to sell for I have no idea why they try to sell medicine on TV, because it's the doctor that prescribes it, but, you know, this is good for you, except it does things like creates baldness, pain in your butt, you know, all these, a whole
try dating and living with someone on that stuff.
Anyway, but it turns out that the serotonin reuptake inhibitors create suicidal and homicidal emotions in people universally. It's one of the things that you're supposed to work very closely with your doctor, and that the first sign of a thought of suicide or the first sign of aggression, the doctor's supposed to make adjustments to the medication and you know, catch the problem. But that isn't happening. They're just passing these things out like candy, and they're universally declaring people in need of these drugs when they are not in need of the drugs, and it creates a whole bunch of really dangerous situations.
An inclination to suicidal behavior is the effect, not the side effect. It's
right,
the effect.
Right. It turns out that it is the effect, and you couple this, you know, you give that to an otherwise person who's, you know, in the society, legal, and he's able to buy guns, it doesn't matter how many regulations you have, especially when you consider the option of some crazy person stealing a gun from somebody who has it legally. So it's not the guns, per se, it's the serotonin reuptake inhibitors that you have to watch. And, you know, admit to the people that these drugs are being misprescribed, admit that the drugs shouldn't probably be prescribed at all in the first place, and admit that they're the cause, not the guns. Ta-da, next. Okay, we have one more caller. Looks like we don't have to play the other videos. Oh, okay. Well, we do have another call. Okay, go ahead, caller.
Hey, call me skeptical, but do you think there's any possibility one of our three-letter national government agencies, or somebody else for that matter, could have assisted those three young people that had the shootout with the police officer and left the police dog dead last week? You guys know about that, right?
No, I haven't even heard about it. Of course, you know.
You hear about that?
I'm not as thorough as you might think.
just 2 days. I think it was Tuesday night into Wednesday morning. The police got a call for a burglary at Blumenthal Uniforms up in Southwest Barber Boulevard, just up by 30th there.
Right.
And they chased these guys down Capitol Highway, and can't remember the name of the side street, but it was about halfway between Taylor's Ferry and Garden Home Road there. And so anyway, that's where they had the shootout with the cops. And these guys had the one guy that was a shooter, I think from what I could see from the news, there was one guy that was a shooter. He had like an AR-15 style rifle, or actually an AR-15. I'm not sure. I heard both reports.
I saw that. But yeah, it's funny how they emphasize that it was an assault rifle. It wasn't an assault rifle at all. It was just an ordinary single action semi-automatic rifle that's been dolled up with some plastic. You know, so.
Oh, okay. They said one news. In other words, said it was.
In other words, it was not an M16, which would have been an assault rifle. It was probably an M15, which is just an ordinary rifle that looks like the M16. I mean,
or an AR-15. Now, one news, I think, I can't remember which news channel it was here, local news, said that it was an AR-15, and another one said it was an AR-15-like rifle.
Yeah, so okay, because they have a whole bunch of different ones, the Bushmaster and other things like that. But the deal is, when you hear them say AR-15, listen to this, when you say AR-15, and then in the same breath they call it an assault rifle, that's a lie. There isn't going to be an assault in the world using that rifle.
Well, now you,
maybe the automatic one, the fully automatic one, the version of the M16 is an assault rifle, but not the AR-15. So let's get it straight. You know, I'm not exactly a gun toter or whatever.
I would like you two guys to put your brains together and just see what you can come up with.
Brain soup.
As far as if there could be any kind of any. I'll put it this way. Did anybody encourage them or help them along attain those weapons? Kind of like Fast and Furious into Mexico, you know?
Oh, yeah, right.
I'd like to address part of this.
Go ahead. The government supplies the weapons and then busts you for them. Right. I know about that. Go ahead.
Is that it?
Well, I'll answer it off the air, but it's also I wanted to respond in relation to Michael Rupert's suicide.
Oh, okay.
Whenever the caller is done making their comments.
Right. Okay. But that's just why I want people to ponder is, could there have been, well, I guess the question to ask, where did these kids get their guns, and was anybody encouraging them to do what they did? You know, to break into a police uniform and a supply shop.
And I know where that place is, that police uniform and supply shop. Yeah, so when I get a chance to get online, I'm going to look up that story.
Wait for this. Now, they not only sell uniforms there, badges, guns, armor, vests, all kinds of things that a cop would need, or firefighters for that matter, because they carry firefighter uniforms there too. But the point of it is, and badges, but the main thing is they had guns there, and I can't remember if these guys, I know the news vulture said they got away with some badges, some uniforms, and some vests and whatnot, but I'm just wondering, did anybody put them up to this, or did they foment this thing all by them little selves?
I don't know, but Bill?
I would like to find out for sure. So if you guys are in the news gathering business, you might look into that. Of course, once I mention anything about it on the TV here, they're all going to be covering their behinds, you know, to kind of sweep away the trail. But
I'm sure if there's any covering, they're already doing it.
Bill, can I
take 3 minutes before go off the air and explain the situation?
Yeah,
all
sure.
Right.
Well, okay, thanks, caller. We'll look into that. I will just tell you right now, I'm less of a news gatherer than a video jockey, but go ahead.
I did want to take 3 minutes. So I am back in town. I've been back about 3 weeks, and I became homeless in 2011. That's what ended my news gathering and sharing with you experience, that Bill helped me, my best friend in Portland, Oregon, for those last few years. And I begged for help before I left Portland on the air. I need help. I lost my job. I have nowhere to go. And that's why I left Portland, and that's why I stopped doing Outside the Box TV. For the last 2.5 years, I have been traveling throughout America to get back to news gathering with nothing but a pack on me. And I've had the experience of living the survival situation, living the disaster, living for 10 months without anybody emailing you, wondering whatever happened to Alex Ansary, that guy was on Access TV. So Michael Rupert killed himself? Guess what? Michael Rupert's not the only person that hurts, that has contemplated taking their own life. And there are people that work and sweat every day to bring you the news, and I am one of them. And it's a miracle I haven't killed myself. When I felt completely abandoned by Portland, Oregon, that hurt more than anything you will ever know. And I thank Bill for letting me say that. That's why I left. So I left and I went to Colorado, same area where Michael Rupert did, to heal my heart from feeling broken by Portland. On the air for 6 years, using my birth name, being of an ethnic background that could get targeted, but doing it anyways. I could not just allow myself to live in my truck. So I basically accepted the job. That's why I went to Dallas. In Colorado, off the grid, I ponder these things. What are the most important things, you know, messages to bring back to Portland? You know, there's a lot of anger and emotions I myself got swept up into, and fear. And there's a different perspective that I have about some of these things. What I can say is, Don't wait till someone kills themselves to appreciate them for who they are. We often see this with rock stars. We often see this with other people. And so it was difficult for me to leave Portland, but now coming back and coming back homeless, living in my truck in the city where I was born and on the air for 6 years, man, that's really brought a lot of, I've had to work on a lot of spirit, you know, definitely have had to find my inner strength in new ways the last few weeks. So I'm back in Portland and I will try to address some of the things that you guys mentioned and will continue to live simply. But I put up my email and information on a graphic there. It's got my email, my message number, my Facebook page, it's got the website, it's got my YouTube. That's how you can find me. That's my contact information. 503-329-3041, 503-329-3041, voicemail only. I don't have a cell. And so I'm just trying to find a way that I can find a job in a city where so many people from California came. A job, anything, so I'm not just literally living in my truck. The sooner I can do that, and I actually have to pay fees to come back to Access TV. I actually have to pay money to, it's not a big deal, it's just to learn a class. And with that, that's where I'm at. I'm working real hard right now to keep the faith that I can get things going in Portland so I can get my show back and address those things, meet people like Wesley and cover these stories. But if I can't even feed myself, or it makes the news gathering part pretty difficult. And that's all I got to say. Thank you so much.
Okay,
I'm glad to be back in Portland.
Right on, and it's good to see you again. And I'll extend the invitation now. Come by any Saturday, and you can be the co-host anytime.
And I'll help out where I can.
Crossing the Rubicon, folks. Go out and buy your copy before there aren't any anymore.
I'm glad I still have my copy. It was great to have him here in Access in 2005 when he came here and talked about, you know, his ideas on the fossil fuel situation. And
you know, it makes me think that we really should be inviting the icons of the 9/11 movement to this, even if the worst thing they're going to do is say no. And like, I'd really like Sibel Edmonds just moved to Oregon. She lives in Bend. Mm-hmm. I'd love to have her on. David Chandler, of course. We've made a couple videos, or one video, I guess, is all he made. It seems like mm-hmm. a million of them already. And I played, David Chandler has a really good video from Eugene that we played a section of last time. So there's lots of good opportunities right here in Oregon without going too far.
I just wanted to add, even for PCN, I'm so glad this place is still here. It's better than ever. And it's easier now because I used to spend a lot of time, guys, after the show, taking boxes home to get the tapes on the internet. And you helped me quite a bit too. Now things are tapeless. It's getting easier for us to share this information. Mm-hmm. So use the resources. Use the resources available. And Access TV is a very special place. You'll reach people that you won't reach on YouTube. On YouTube, they're looking for those specific videos or their subscribers. On Access TV, you reach people randomly that are watching, some of them, mass media mind control. So this is a great deprogramming channel to deprogram from all types of mass media mind control.
And, okay, we got 1 minute left. They should be rolling the credits now. And we'll be back next Saturday. It won't be preempted again. This quarter anyway, but I don't quite understand how their scheduling works. But anyway, I should have known that. I knew that last time, and I said, see you next week. And mm-hmm. then I got a bunch of emails saying, where were you? You know, every time I'm not on the air, they think, uh-oh. Dun, 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 dun.
Right.
But anyway, again, crossing the Rubicon, the decline of the American empire at the end of the age of oil.
Oh, and check out him on Vice. Check out the Vice channel and see Apocalypse Man if you haven't seen it already.
Oh, okay.
Featuring Michael Ruppert.
Michael Ruppert.
Yeah.
Next Saturday.
Thank you, Bill. It was fun.
All right.